Thank you, everybody. I'm Gary Vogren. Good to see everybody's face. Can't wait to see you in person. I'd like to call the Franklin Public Arts Commission meeting of April 7th, 2021 to order. Thanks for everybody's time. First off, I'd like to introduce Megan. She's the newbie on the board. Mayor appointed at the BOMA session to replace Ellie. So I just want to give Megan props and thanks for joining our board and welcome. And if you have anything to say, please do, or chime in as you wish to welcome yourself.
I don't have much to say at the moment, but I would love to thank you all for having me come on this commission. I'm really excited. I have a huge passion for art and yeah, just excited to be a part of it.
Thank you for volunteering and being part of our board.
Yeah.
Thank you. By the way, I miss you guys. Miss the chamber being next to us in our building. Hope you guys are enjoying.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so we got to start off with a roll call for attendance. So I'll name everybody. If you just say you're present or absent, if you're not here, we'll just sign in. So, Brandy? Absent?
I'm here, sorry.
Oh, there she is. Okay. Hey, Brandy. Sherry?
Present.
Thank you. Julie is absent, correct? Is that what I heard? Kelly? I see
here.
You there. Hey, thank Kelly.
You. Good to
David.
See you.
Here.
Thank you. Ashley.
Present.
Hey, Ashley.
Hey.
Megan.
I'm here.
Nan.
Here.
Hey, Nan. Gary Vogan, present. Thank you. Okay, item number two. Consideration of resolution 2021-73, a resolution declaring that the Franklin Public Arts Commission shall meet on April 7th, 2021 and conduct its essential business by electronic means rather than being required to gather a quorum of the members physically present in the same location because it is necessary to protect the health, safety, and welfare of Tennesseans in the light of COVID-19 outbreak. So do we have a motion to adopt this?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Properly seconded. Who was the second?
Ashley.
Ashley. Okay. Okay. Motion for approval. Brandy?
Yes.
Sherry?
Yes.
Julie's absent. Kelly?
Yes.
David?
Yes.
Ashley?
Yes.
Nan?
Yes.
Thank you. Megan?
Sorry.
Yes.
Gary is an aye. So the ayes have it, except for the absent. Okay. Thank you. So I got to read this long dissertation as well. So stick with me. The Franklin Public Arts Commission meeting will limit physical access to the meeting room due to current conditions on public gatherings to prevent further spread of COVID-19 and protect the health, safety, and welfare of the City of Franklin officials, staff, and citizens. Accommodations have been made to ensure that the public is able to participate in the meeting. The public may participate in the following ways. Call into the conference meeting at 312-626-6799, meeting ID 921-8208-9162, passcode 426-449. To listen to the meeting and make comments during any public comment period. Callers will be unmuted and given an opportunity to ask questions and provide comments during the meeting at specific times. The public may also email comments to the City of Franklin at franklintn.gov to be read aloud during the meeting. Emailed comments were accepted until April 5th at 5 p.m. Okay. So item number three, citizen comments. This is the time for citizens to make any comments on anything not on the agenda. I'll ask staff to read any emails if they have some. So staff, is there anything come in?
No, we didn't receive any emails and there's no one on the line.
Gary, I have a point of order. Our information on our packet is different as far as the conference meeting and the meeting ID. And I just want to make sure we're being transparent. I don't know why there's a difference in what I'm looking at and what you read.
Oh.
So, I don't know, Monique, do we need to go back and at least give the correct meeting ID for the record?
I have it on my phone if I can amend that, I guess.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that we're being consistent and transparent because it's different what you read.
In the past, it was different than what I have on my phone.
So.
Okay, so I'll amend for citizen comment. I'll amend that call-in conference meeting ID is 931-9961-96941. Calling in the number, area code 1-312-626-6799. Passcode 676636.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think I left this one over, Gary, from the last roll call agenda that we did.
Okay.
But it should have been correct in what was published.
Very good. Thank you, Brandy, for pointing that out. Okay, so no citizen comments. Item number 4, consideration of approval of the November 9, 2020 minutes. Any comments, corrections? And then ask for a motion.
Move for approval.
Second?
Second.
Who was that?
Gary.
Gary, second. Thank you. Okay, all in favor? Brandy?
Yes.
Sherry?
Yes.
Julie's absent. Kelly?
Yes.
David?
Yes.
Ashley?
Yes.
Nan?
Yes.
Megan?
Yes.
Gary Vogren, yes. The ayes have it. Okay, item number 5, discussion of new city hall facility design and public art. This one, I reached out to you, Nan, if you mind maybe co-chairing this as vice chair, potentially, because I am on this team as part of this design. And I'll kind of contribute to the presentation along with my colleague, Matt Taylor, with Studio 8. So unless I can do both, I'm not sure. But if you can, I'll just open it up and give my comment, then maybe you come in and just kind of ask for any questions or comments and maybe run that element portion of it, I guess. It won't be a voting item, so it's just for
you. I see Kelly's face. Kelly, what's your comment there? I think you might need to recuse yourself and let her start it off.
It's fine. Yeah. If he just turns the meeting over to the vice chair, that will be fine. And then I was going to offer that I could take over if you'd like.
That'd be good, because I have no idea what this item is. I mean, I have a general idea, but not. Yes. Okay.
We are here before you to talk about public art ideas for the new City Hall. Last fall, the Board of Mayor and Aldermen voted to approve consulting services to launch the design process for the envisioning of a new City Hall in its current location on the historic public square. So the intent is to tear down the one-story building that exists there today and replace it with a functional city hall that contributes to downtown Franklin, contributes to the city, and is efficient and a collaboration space for employees. But with this comes an opportunity to really look at the site as a whole and talk about public art ideas. And that's why we're before you tonight. So I'm gonna turn it over to Matt Taylor and Gary to lead the conversation about public art and hear your thoughts and ideas about what we should consider as we start to plan and consider the new City Hall facility. Go ahead, Matt.
Okay, well, thanks. Gary and I are gonna tag team this and we may step on each other's toes a bit, but this is a bit of an informal process and an introduction that we are very early in the planning and process for a new City Hall. And really appreciate all of you taking the time today to share any thoughts and questions and comments with us. We're not here to present to you what we plan to do relative to public art, rather than we're looking at different opportunities and how public art can be incorporated into the project to really get your feedback. We're in this public engagement phase of this. And so this is here for us to share some potential ideas, get your thumbs up, your thumbs downs, your, you know, what we don't know, we don't cares, and really hear what you all have to say and have a discussion about it. So I'm gonna just sort of introduce things, and then I'm going to let Gary talk a little bit more about the specifics relative to public art and some of the site design and elements that we're going to talk about. I do want to point out, in addition to Gary, Anna Ruth Kimbrough works with me at Studio 8 Design. She's here, and Matt Edwards works with OHM Advisors, which is our partner architectural firm on the project. So we've got a couple of representatives from the design team here today that we all want to hear your feedback, and that with this many ears, we should be able to get some good notes down. So I'm going to share my screen here. Monique, I think I need you to let me.
Yeah, hold on.
And Gary, I'll just keep this up and let you tell me when to change pages if you want.
That's fine. Yeah, perfect.
Okay. I think you can now, Matt.
Okay, there we go. Let's see. Okay. All right. You guys see this aerial photo of the square here?
Yep.
We do have a fairly good sized team really doing planning and programming for this project on the front end. And the goal is by the end of the year to develop a master plan for what the future City Hall might be. We will not start actually designing the building itself until phase two, which will happen hopefully starting in January of next year. Overall, the timeline, we're hoping City Hall will be completed by around 2026. So we have a long road ahead of us. We're gonna have a lot of these conversations, and we want to continue to get your feedback and the feedback of the rest of the community. So here's a quick outline of what we're gonna talk about today. We'll look at where the site is, which I think you all probably are very familiar with. We're gonna talk about streetscape, open space around the building, potential pocket parks, inscriptions, public art, and water elements. All of these things could be considered public art in different fashions. And so we want to talk about the opportunities for what's appropriate and what you all think might be encouraged to factor into a master plan. As you look, obviously here's the square and the roundabout and the existing City Hall Mall building. It's a lovely building that has lived its life. And I think if we're all successful, then we're going to knock it down in a few years and replace it with something that's a little more in keeping with the rest of the square. The Second Avenue parking garage will remain. It's in great shape, no reason to do anything with it. The Pultite Theater and Greenhouse are historic structures on the southeast corner that we will protect and preserve, and we want to be respectful to. 231 Public Square building is obviously not going anywhere and will remain. This was sort of a first separate phase of improving this corner of the square, where we have a lot of history and richness on the other three sides. The courthouse is obviously an important landmark that we will want to show deference to and figure out the best ways to relate to. And then we step into the other historic structures down Third Avenue with Pope Moran House, Biscuit Love, the church, and then we get into the residential neighborhood to the south. We'll be looking at streetscape. I know y'all are familiar with the streetscape improvements that have happened around the different areas of downtown. And I think public art has a great potential for interaction with the streetscape and how those things can be incorporated together rather than thought of separately. So with that, as we start thinking about streetscape, I'm gonna let Gary talk a little bit more about this, but we're looking at what those edges around the building and the spaces around the building might be.
So not only given the crucial element of the building, it's really about the surrounding fabric it sits in, particularly the streets, the walkability, the pedestrian experience, how cars travel. You've all been down Third Avenue. You've seen the blank facade of what that building is. It's all brick, no windows, very sterile, inactive, not a great site to walk by. So the intent is, in addition to Third Avenue, Church Street, and some minor improvements to Second, because Second's pretty much laid out the way it is. We may just do some different paving, but really engage the community on the streetscape, in particular Third and Church. And when we get into design, this is something that we all talk about as landscape architects and planners, that you want to have a great streetscape design. So this diagram basically shows the different zones that are within a great streetscape. And what's unique to this, it's a little bit wider. It's a much wider streetscape than what you commonly see in downtown Franklin on Main Street. That Main Street dimension is about 12 feet from back of curb to the building. So it's comfortable yet very tight at the same time. You can maybe snuggle a few chairs in there in front of McCurry's Pub, but outside of that, it's very compressed. So we really want to open up this zone in terms of Third Avenue to incorporate a flex zone next to parallel parking. The flex zone is the purple, which houses street trees, potentially public art, landscape, signage, site furnishings, benches, bike racks, things of that nature. That would be brick lined most likely. So that's just a buffer zone from the public pedestrian zone, which is the circulation zone in yellow. That is going to be 8 foot clear, typically a concrete surface, but is a buffer off the street from the flex zone. Then adjacent to the circulation zone, you have the tenant zone, where you have potentially outdoor dining zones, you've got signage, you've got window shopping, you've got areas to sit out on the street. It's comfortable, and that's probably 5 to 10 feet, depending what's there. So you're looking at about a 25 to 27 foot streetscape from back of curb to the building face. And it kind of works for the building face, comes in and out, creates little nooks and crannies in the building, but is a more comfortable space as opposed to what we typically see on Main Street, what we have today. So just want to walk through that element, but a great kind of graphic to show what could be accomplished in a streetscape of this size. And incorporate art. Go ahead, Matt, next slide. So in addition to streetscape, there's opportunities for little pocket parks and open spaces along the streetscape, at the street corners, to really kind of erode the building back or move the building up to the street or anchor various corners of the blocks that could allow for these little pocket parks where there's informal seating, outdoor areas to kind of connect and get on your laptop if you're in the office or inside the city building, community gathering, but a lot of areas that kind of work with the building to create little pockets or little nooks that we don't have today as part of the new building design to allow for seating, outdoor plazas, and any artwork that could potentially kind of animate these spaces. So these are just images. These are not designs. These are just thoughts and ideas that we could introduce to either the ground plane, which most of these images are. There's a couple rooftop gardens on here that overlook the square. We're thinking potentially there's areas that are rooftops on the building on the second upper levels that look down into the square, down to the streetscape that could incorporate art as well. So those are just different ideas to animate the streetscape and create little pocket parks and nooks within the building. Thanks, Matt. Same thing here, just more kind of more intimate spaces that allow for these zones to happen adjacent to the building, little corridors, little pocket areas to allow for just different activities as you're waiting for a meeting or you're about to work with the city, you have an idea, an area to kind of come together and use for civic events as well, public speaking, public spaces, part of the Main Street Festival, just kind of all ties together with the streetscape. So just different ideas there. Plenty of opportunities for art opportunities. Next slide, Matt. We've been thinking about inscriptions on the building. You've all seen these on various types of buildings. We just see a great opportunity in terms of art, both on the ground plane, in pavers or plaques, manhole covers, building corners. We've got a couple things on in the streetscape that have that. The benches have some plaques as well, but not only on the interior of the building doing something commemorative to the city, but externally on the paving surface, the building, to just identify various people, persons that are intricate to our community and have opportunity to showcase on the building. So just ideas here and thoughts, something to chew on as we go into this. Next slide, Matt. This is kind of a little sample that we saw in Greenville, South Carolina. This is part of a Franklin Tomorrow trip, and many of you may have seen this, maybe not, but this is kind of a play on the mice and storyboard telling for children to find these mice throughout the city, kind of a little game challenge, kind of what we did here at the city of Franklin with the little horses. Very similar, these little art pieces just scattered around town, animate the streetscape and create a little trail system of some sort. But there's so many different opportunities, as we've talked about as a board, to kind of bring different opportunities for art, be it something like this, storyboards, wind chime, you know, just anything that can be possible along a streetscape. Next slide, Matt. These are just images that we've kind of gathered. Obviously, we know the Franklin one up there, the mural that was just done. We've got the Fuller story in the square. We've got just different opportunities that maybe animate the corners of the streets to, you know, bring in the Ben Franklin, Williamson County, just some way to incorporate art. Again, these are just ideas, nothing set in stone. These are just something that we could really animate the corners of streetscapes or along the streetscapes that I just mentioned. We have that room to do things like that and add murals to the building, whatever may be opportunities to showcase themselves as part of this design. So just really want to open this up to discussion. I think that's the last slide, Matt, maybe? The other one was, you know, water just gravitates everybody to a space. I mean, that's something we use commonly in a lot of our designs, the sound, the atmosphere, the ambiance of the space, and how you can really create cool spaces with simple water sounds of either scuppers or falling bowls, or just mirror kind of sheer water surfaces. So where we can bring something like this into a space, I think it really creates something special. So you can do really something unique in terms of art in regard to that as well.
And I just want to add too, we've talked a lot about the history of this site, and obviously downtown is steeped with history, but while the other three corners are more solid in terms of the age of the buildings and the richness of their history and architectural character, this site has changed over time. There have been different buildings over time, you know, up to the City Hall Mall, which clearly is not of the same era as the rest there. And through some of those studies and activities of what's happened, I think the public art gives us some opportunities to help tell the story of the site and the role of this corner in Franklin's history as well. So we can give some additional meaning and richness to these opportunities.
Perfect. Thank you, Matt. Is there another slide?
So I think with that, we really just kind of want to open, we'll come back to this, but I think if anybody had any comments or feedback on any of these aspects that you really like or think are more appropriate than others, or, you know, that you're enamored with, we certainly are looking for feedback and comments from everybody. Don't be shy.
I mean, for me personally, I've thought, in addition just to our work, we've talked about, you can do something cool with bike racks. You can do, like we've done before, you can do something with the benches. You can do something, the banners of the streetscapes. I mean, there's so many different opportunities in addition to just what we showed here, but even those little details in the pavement and bike racks and ornamentation are kind of just unique opportunities along the streetscape.
I think these are all fantastic ideas and I'm excited about it. I would love to see one of the spaces available where we could have rotating exhibitions, where a piece of art could be somewhere, maybe in a green space for 6 months or whatever it is, and it rotates out. So maybe transitional spaces where they have a flexibility of bringing in, like maybe this, that circular, that first one on the top left, that's what made me think of it. If we had opportunities for, rotating exhibitions. And so it would keep it not static, the opposite of static, whatever that is. Yeah, that would be pretty super cool. Yeah.
It's a great way of activating it and giving people a reason to come back and something for visitors to see when they come to town. We've talked about mm-hmm. that interior of the building as well, with some of the educational and history components, but the city, I know Monique has been involved with changing the art out in the City Hall Mall gallery mm-hmm. type space over time as well, but this does give us a great opportunity to do some of that on the outside and activate the streetscape in a whole new way.
Yep.
I really like the water features. I mean, I just know that down at the First Bank at Five Points, there's people that sit around that water feature all the time. I just think that's a nice touch.
I'd like to comment on the fact that you've been so thoughtful about the different zones coming from the street all the way up to the building itself, because when you walk around downtown Franklin, as I did at lunchtime today, on a beautiful day, people are just so desperate to be out and about, but it is tight. And it's like, and when they've, you know, where they put in some chairs and tables, which I totally get and love to sit out there, but then it's really hard to walk and it pushes people into the road. So basically very thoughtful. I think that's going to create a really interesting corridor for people to walk through. And I like the idea that there might be some, you know, some kind of art that you can gather up in there in the tenant zone and some of the windows or something like that. Anyway, just a very cool, thoughtful approach. I like it.
I just wanted to make a quick comment about the slide that had the mice on it. I don't know which slide that was. I love, I like all the things that you presented, but I love the thought of having something for the kids that's a way for the kids to interact with the space and interact with art, I think is important. So I would love to see something similar, which has been done in the past too, but something in this space I think would be a really great addition. So I really appreciated that portion, so.
Billy.
I wonder with that point, David, to not make the horse scavenger hunt that's already in place compete with something else, if it could just be an extension of what's already there, which will make people see it maybe here, but then go venture out to the other sites where the sculpture of the horses are. You know what I mean? I think you don't need so much of one thing, but if you've already got something that's, where are you at, Megan? Help me here, because you're
sorry. I'm here. I was trying. I could not unmute for some reason, so I apologize. I'm glad you brought that up.
Yeah, I don't want a two projects to compete, but I think mm-hmm. if the having a different site for what's already in place will only increase the eyeballs in other places.
Yeah, and I think I was going to ask if it would be a possibility of either placing a horse at City Hall or somehow extending the current scavenger hunt to where, I don't know, maybe there's like, either it's the same horse or a smaller version where there's multiple horses around the new City Hall or something like that.
Cool.
Almost like a mini scavenger hunt there within the big one. I don't know. But if there could be some sort of extension to the one that already exists, that would be awesome, especially because of the history of that particular spot, which if I recall correctly, was a watering trough for horses.
I was going to say, Megan, we talked about this, some of the civic leaders yesterday in the history of the site, but there was
a
shop, there were livery stables, mm-hmm. a couple of places downtown, which if you've not seen the historic photos of them, they didn't look like barns. They looked like downtown buildings with brick detailing and parapets and these mm-hmm. grand arches where people literally came and drove their horse and buggy in to park them, for lack of a better term. But this corner where City Hall is was kind of that crossroads where everybody came together. You watered your horse when you came to town. You might have gotten your horse reshoed. And so I think you guys are tapping into something that, to Brandy's comment about competing, I think it starts to weave together a lot of different opportunities instead of competing. And I mean, there's even an outreach to Harlansdale with its history of the horses and Midnight Sun. And so, you know, these are the kind of things that are awesome and can be interpreted in so many ways, but then really start to support each other and make it uniquely Franklin, not just, hey, we saw this and Nashville had catfish, so we have catfish too. Or, you know, it's something really special and personalized to this site and this project and this city. So I think you guys are, this is wonderful feedback and starts tying in with other things we didn't even really talk about today.
And if I could also mention, you know, I think just coming from the visitor perspective, I love this. I absolutely love it. And, you know, I've had many conversations with Kelly Harwood in the past about getting more visitors over into that Second Avenue District area where there are art galleries, there is art and antiques. And so using this as sort of somewhat of a gateway almost to that area of town will be huge for speaking in terms of the leisure traveler, the visitor. So I think this is going to be just an awesome gateway to that area of town.
So I'll probably see this several thousands of times in the next 5 years. But one thing that I think about, we had at Capital Investment last week, they were talking about changing streetscape downtown to where they would move the trees and get rid of the grates, and it would really almost cut into the parking on Main Street. So if you can go back, I don't know who's meaning this, the
I've got it, Brandy.
Street view.
This Thank one? You.
Yes. So I heard parallel parking mentioned, and that scares me, unless this is Third Avenue, because there's existing parallel parking.
I would. Yes.
Okay. So my thought too is you don't want to oversaturate one quadrant with public art, which I don't think there's a too big of a fear of that. But I think we need to be strategic about what kind of art we place where. And it kind of follows up with Megan's comment. If you think about a mural and you think about the opportunities for photos and things like that, you want it to either be where it's safe and or there is parking for people to be able to access it. I don't know if that would be appropriate at the square, just from an aesthetic situation. So I would imagine that would be more of a Third Avenue or a South Margin. And that could organically, Megan, pull people towards that Second Avenue District, towards Kelly's and the Ice House and all those opportunities. I just think being strategic about what goes where, which I'm sure we will be, and keeping things that are a little bit more tangible, like the water features and things like that, in the walkability of maybe the square quadrant.
That's a great point, Brandy. We talked about that as the design team and even with planning staff, and that we've got the artwork, you know, covered to a certain degree with the Fuller story and some other things in the square that we can really draw people. As you said, if we can start drawing people down Third, down the church, and then Second, and really kind of create that circulation movement and really be strategic, that's really key. I totally agree.
Well, and David's comment about engaging kids too. You know, yeah. I think there's a lot of retailers and restaurants that will tell you, hey, we're drawing the parents in by making the kids say, mom, dad, I want to stop there. So if you have a pocket park that has a rotating exhibition and potentially a water feature, and there's a few horses in the scavenger hunt to find, the parents can sit and let the kids sort of run around a little. And there's ways of sort of weaving some of these other elements all together. But really, then you're also creating, as Gary said, almost a trail and a connect the dots pathway for people to now connect all the way from Five Points to City Hall and potentially up to Harpeth Square, even that they could start incorporating this into their sidewalks and streetscape. So
this is your chance actually to maybe get your Franklin sculpture done if it doesn't happen at Bicentennial Park.
One of these days, my Ben Franklin will happen.
Well, then hopefully my Jimmy Gentry will happen at Five Points. So
I've been working on this Ben Franklin since 2010.
I know, babe.
Maybe before that.
It's about that time, yeah.
Yeah.
It's due. Any other feedback out there? Don't be shy. If that's it, well.
I haven't heard Kelly Harwood say a word. We're all trying to get you business and you're not saying a word.
There, I'll mute it. So I love the idea of all that, and especially pushing more business my direction. I just didn't want to say that, but I'm very thankful for that. I'm a little concerned about the how the streetscaping will be. Church Avenue, I don't know what that's going to be. I don't know how City Hall is going to look facing the back of the gallery. We have parking back here, and I don't know if that's going to be parking across the street or if it's going to be, I don't know what the plans are for that, but I hope it interacts with the gallery and the property on my side. And I own the little greenhouse, so I hope that somehow will always work in with the plans.
Yeah, Kelly, we've literally done walks around with city staff, with the design team and everybody, looking both ways from every sidewalk. We've documented the buildings that will remain and face City Hall, as well as what's happening on the City Hall block, and are really sensitive to the height and massing, how it changes across this site from Main Street to Church Street. When you go from the density of 231 to the lower residential scale of the neighborhood along Church and the gallery there. And so we haven't really started designing yet. So I can't give you an answer of exactly what the streetscape is on Church Street, but I can tell you, I know we're looking at each edge independently. We want them all to tie together and feel like one place, but we have become very hyper aware that we have a different context as we go around the edges of the site, both horizontally and vertically. And so all of that we want to treat with respect and make it appropriate to the setting. So the building itself may step down as we go across the site in height as it starts to approach Church Street. Depending on how big it winds up being, we may not even go all the way to the edge of Church Street and see what happens with future expansion or open space at the south end. We're exploring all options right now and how we might incorporate additional parking, because we're going to be bringing new visitors and City Hall is going to grow. And how do we accommodate parking, which we know is already at a premium in the downtown district? So.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks for bringing up the comment, though. Every detail matters, and we don't want to overlook anything. And I don't want to chase anybody off, but before we leave, I just wanted to land on this slide and share with y'all that we have created a website for the project. So as things, reports and studies and ideas evolve, they're going to be posted here. The city has posted this on Twitter and Facebook on its social media sites with a link. So feel free to chat back there early and often as things develop and other meetings are scheduled. Hopefully we're going to move to meetings in person and less on our computers, especially over the course of this project, given how much time we have. But I did want to share the website link with you all while we were here today as well.
I have a quick question. So how is the public going to be engaged in talking about public art in particular with this project? I'm sure there are people have lots of opinions, and we need to, kind of whittle it down. And is there a plan for that, or how's that going to shake down?
Well, I'm going to answer that a little more globally, which public art is a piece of, and that is that we are in the very beginning stages of public engagement right now. And so You're one of the organizations that we really wanted to value, because you have a very specific aspect of this that's important to talk about. But then there's going to be general public meetings and chats, which are at least starting online. We're going to continue to do this for months and as Brandy said, years to come, the duration of the project and how things evolve. But Later this fall in August, we'll be presenting more of a report, and Kelly may want to talk to this a little bit in terms of, here's what we heard in the first round of public engagement. We want to turn around and share some of this with everyone, and then ask for a second round of public engagement for comments and feedback to that. That is not going to be the end of this. I think we all, as Franklin residents, and the fact that you all are willing to take the time and be on this commission, you know firsthand how involved this neighbor, this community is in terms of wanting to share their public feedback and their opinions. And and we want to embrace that. We are open to it. That's why we've helped create the website. And there are opportunities on the website to send messages and offer comments as well. So this is never ending. When we end this meeting today, this is not the end of the conversation with you all or with other groups. So that'll continue to come, and you all will be able to see the results of that and weigh in on. I'm glad somebody really wants that, but I don't know that as the Public Arts Commission, we think that's the best idea for this spot or this location, or in the global thing of what we're trying to do, maybe we can focus those energies in different directions. So there'll be lots of opportunities for ideas, feedback, reaction, and we want to find the commonality and the consensus of the things that everybody cares about to figure out how to incorporate that into the design, and what does that do to shape what this project is really going to be. So
yeah, I just want to make sure there's representation from all the different neighborhoods, as I know y'all do as well. I that was the one thing that I was thinking about, the public part, and public art, to ensure that all the voices are heard as best as possible, because I know it's a huge undertaking. So I totally understand that.
This is a really high profile project. It's a really important quadrant of our public square in the very center of our historic downtown. So we want to make sure that we are thoroughly engaging the public too. We have a survey that's going to come out. It's online mid-month, and we will send you that link. And please feel free to share with all your friends, your colleagues. We want to get as much input as we can. We'll also have a link from the website that Matt talked about. We'll also have a public meeting in May, and then following our round of engagement, the consultant team is going to get to work drawing a preliminary master plan. And that's what Matt mentioned, will be released in August. And then we'll have another public meeting and another survey to gauge the design direction from the preliminary master plan. So there's a lot of opportunity. We know how important this is.
So we want to hear from y'all now, so that when we come around in August, you don't look at us cross-eyed and say, you weren't listening, or why didn't you think of this? We want to come out of the gate, you know, really embracing all of that, so that you see your voice in these, you know, preliminary ideas that come about.
I am curious about the main entrance. Is there plans on any of that yet?
Well, that's one of the questions we're asking in the survey, is historically the entrance has always been on the square. The old original city hall was on the northeast corner, and in fact, you can see the city office's sign still on the brick wall there if y'all haven't noticed it before. But and now we have the main entrance on Third Avenue with a secondary entrance on the square. We are looking at where do people feel like is the best, most appropriate place for that. We want to think as we create a new building in the historic context of downtown, and what needs to be state of the art and modern about the way it operates, and take things like security into control so that we don't have people coming in from too many different directions and doors. So I think that's a really important question. And Kelly, I'm glad you brought it up, that I would ask all of you all to think about that. And if you have strong opinions, I think clearly the top two most visible choices for the presence of a city hall are Third Avenue and the square. We have the historic precedent of both in a way, but we are asking that question of the public.
Does it make any sense, Matt, to straddle both streets? And that's probably not the appropriate architectural word, but to straddle both sides so that you almost enter, you have this great huge open space on the corner that directs you to a door. You know what I mean?
That it may, Brandy, and we've actually talked about how we pay attention to the courthouse across the street and pay attention to the square and the uses of the different festivals and activities that happen on the square. The square acts a bit like a plaza now, where you have the few steps up to that entrance. But it's not, in some cases, it's a little limiting in its size as well to serve as a stage and have room for people out there. So we're talking about whether we need some plaza space, open space in the front, quote unquote, square side, or do we have the pocket parks as we go around the building? And how does the entrance work into that? So
are there setback requirements? I mean, it is our city hall, so I'm sure we could get a modification.
I think you have a safe bet there. I think the context of the site sets more of the kind of build to edges than any setbacks in zoning. We're pretty safe from a zoning standpoint with everything that we've talked about today. And I think we have some flexibility on deciding where those edges are and what's outdoor, open space, plaza space, how we relate to the square, how we relate to the courthouse, and not take away from the courthouse, try and steal its thunder. So that, but yes, that corner has been the crossroads. So are we in one of those spaces or do we start to approach the corner? I think those are all valid thoughts and questions, and we are interested to hear what people think about that. Ultimately, this is a building that belongs to Kelly and Vernon. Vernon's joined us. We'll tell you this is the living room of the residents of City Hall. This is not our building. It's not our monument. And so all of this public engagement is really in tune with trying to not only serve the citizens through how it operates, but be a building that is going to last 50 to 100 years. And we get the presence and the placement and the design of it right so that it feels like the rest of downtown that has been here for 100 or 200 years in some cases.
If I could jump in, please.
Absolutely.
Good afternoon, everybody. And thank you, Matt and team and Kelly. We've had several of these engagement meetings thus far. And what I would offer is we know that we've shared a lot with you, but please don't underestimate your influence as we go forward. We invite you and encourage you to participate in the upcoming meetings, just to listen to our neighbors, other community leaders. And so they hear from you and you hear from them on what the expectation of their respective expectations are for this prominent corner in our historic downtown. And as Matt and everybody has mentioned, this is just the beginning. But by the time we get towards the end of this year, we do want to have an idea so we can approach the Board of Mayor and Aldermen on the second phase, which is asking the consultant to proceed with schematic designs. So we're actually, this big funnel, we're narrowing it down. But these important steps for particularly artistic people is critical in getting it right and making sure it spans the test of time. Thank you.
Thank you, Vernon. If there's no other discussion,
anything else?
Matt, go ahead.
I was gonna say, you got anything else to add as our public arts and site leader here?
No, I think a lot of it has to do with the little details make things really special. And we're looking at 30,000 feet up right now, but eventually we're going to get down into the weeds and picking, detailed stuff. So as Vernon said, this is very collaborative. It's a big picture idea, thought process for everybody. So just think on it, chew on it. We're all going to be part of this as part of the community. So we just value everybody's input and thank you for your time, Matt, Anna Ruth, and the other Matt. Edwards to just guide us through this process. So we appreciate you bringing this to our board and give us a chance to give you feedback. But as time goes on, I want everybody on this board to be as involved as they can. So thank you. So you guys are welcome to stay on or listen in, Matt and Anna Russo. It's up to you all, but we're going to move on to item number six if we're good with this one. Thank you all.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks everybody. Item number six, moving on. Consideration of proposal for the use of the display window at 4th Avenue parking garage. Staff, if you go ahead and introduce that applicant, we'll go ahead and get that started.
Yeah, I don't know if any of you have noticed, but there's a storefront window in the 4th Avenue parking garage kind of directly across from Meredith's. And it's being used right now by the Battle of Franklin Trust. Mel Furrer, I'm probably not pronouncing that right, but approached the city about a year ago about using that space as kind of a mini gallery. And so we had our law department kind of do some research, and what we found was the city never had an official agreement with the Battle of Franklin Trust. And so if we do decide, if you guys decide to use that space as public art, it would fall under your purview. So you guys would have a say about what goes in there and when it gets changed out. And it would probably have to operate like any other art that we have in City Hall or any other public art where no prices could be shown, or it couldn't be advertised as being for sale. And Mel is online, so if you want to kind of go ahead and go over your proposal. You're muted now, Mel. Can you unmute?
There we go. Yes. Fantastic. All right, you guys, bear with me just a second. I'm not a cat, by the way. Okay. All right. Hey, guys.
Hi.
Boy, City Hall is a tough act to follow, by the way, just so you know. Okay. So I don't know if you've, I would try to be mindful of your time. I don't know if you've had a chance to read my proposal or not, but you kind of get an idea of the situation. I'm currently the director of Rare Prints Gallery. I'm hoping the gallery will be around. We're just not for sure at this point just yet. I know we get a lot of visitors that really love the gallery, and we hate to see it go away. And I know people will literally travel to come see the gallery. I had people come from north of St. Louis just the other day to come to Rare Prints Gallery to see us and talk with us and talk about rare and early prints. So yeah, my whole story is I've always saw the window sitting there. It's such an afterthought, and it's always kind of tired. And I know the folks at Battle of Franklin Trust are, it's one more thing to keep up with. I chatted with them about it, about using it, and they gave me their blessing, and a lot of other folks gave me their blessing about it. I know obviously the tricky thing is that it is part of the city. I have just a number of pieces that are historical. The things that I would show are all would be the earliest, maybe the newest, that would be probably maybe even a World War II show. 1940s would be the very newest things, but pieces that date back to the 15th century even, that I have samples of all around me here. But that was my idea, is if you've read the proposal, to have different shows up that would run every 8 weeks. I would do 2 month shows, change them out, different subject matters, flora, fauna, maps, historical, to offset the Battle of Franklin Trust. If they're allowing me to use that, I would do a Civil War related window that has maybe, you know, Harper's Weeklies in it, Civil War pieces, maybe some maps, that type of thing, all professionally presented, and as well as, you know, artifacts and you know, that type of thing with didactics and all that to describe the pieces. I don't know if you guys have had a chance to look it over, had any questions, but I think it would help address some of the points that you guys were talking about public art, would help Mr. Harwood get some folks closer to his neck of the woods too there. I'm always sending them down to see you, Mr. Kelly, but sometimes they don't know you're down there, and I'm trying to get folks a little off the main street. It's really difficult Rare Prints has had this great location, but it's also comes with a rent that reflects that. And these rare prints aren't something that's a high profit margin area. Matter of fact, most print shops, and there's fewer and fewer of them in cities across the country, are in little pocket shops or little quaint little shops. People always talk about going in these little shops and seeing these neat prints. And that was another thing that made me think about small, intimate spaces like that. And I like the idea that the window could be, you know, well lit, well presented. I would light it with LED lights. It'd be something that could, it would draw people down, people that are waiting for all the restaurants to wait across the street, maybe look at the art that's in the window and learn something from it. As I mentioned in my proposal, I know it gets kind of tricky with it with a governmental type of situation, but if you guys wanted to charge some form of rent, those monies could be set aside for a purpose of donating, you know, to a scholarship or maybe giving a gift certificate for someone to shop downtown at one of our shops or something like that. I'm just spitballing here, just trying to look for a way of using that neat little window in a neat little high traffic area for something practical. Did anybody have any questions about what some of the pieces would be, or do you have any ideas? Are you familiar with the pieces that I would be showing? I've got samples all around me if you'd like to see some. I've got like, this is a John James Audubon. It's very rare. This is the Octavo. The nice thing about rare prints is they generally come from old books. So they're generally smaller in sizes. So anything that I would show or sell would be nothing much larger than 16 by 20 in size. There's cultural pieces like this Native American man. This is hand colored piece from the 1830s. Maybe mix it with artifacts and pieces like this of Native Americans, especially of this area. There's hand-colored botanicals that are really kind of neat. Do a show in the springtime of all sorts of hand-colored botanicals. These are 200 years old, all hand-colored. Maps are great. So we're getting so many people around this area, obviously from California and parts all over. This is one I love to show my California friends that move here. If you'll notice in this map, California is an island. So people click California is an island map. So this is a great example of a small piece. The pieces would stay in the window till the show was over, and then they would be shipped to the client. All the pieces would be glazed with, this is called Optium acrylic. It's the industry standard. It's almost invisible and it's shatterproof. So all the pieces we have conservation quality and ready to ship out to the clients like that. And nothing would leave the window until after the show was over, unless it was a piece of the same type of subject matter that would replace it like that too. It was a rare occasion like that. I have a lot of different really unique topics. This one, ironically, this is a really neat piece. This is a 1 shilling note from Philadelphia. This colonial currency was actually printed in Ben Franklin's print shop, as a matter of fact. If you notice, there's a leaf on the back here. Ben Franklin came up with the way of printing a leaf back in a time where everything was woodcuts. So this is a really neat little historical piece. And I have a number of pieces like that as well too, with a little nod to Franklin as well too. With the window, I'd like to also offer something that's economical, always a little economical piece. I have some really great, fantastic little postcard collection from the turn of the century that are fabulous, whether they're kind of kitsch or something like that, that's historical. For the holidays, we could do a collection of fantastic kind of nativity pieces. These are neat. Some go back as far as like this piece is from the early 1500s. I even have illuminated manuscript pieces. This is about 1440 on this piece. But there's some neat little treasures like this that I think people would really enjoy seeing and learning from, and have the ability to purchase them as well too, which is a nice thing. There'll be QR codes that could lead people to the site where they learn more about it. Also with that, there could also be some kind of cross marketing where maybe people come to the site and I could direct them to some of the shops around downtown or restaurants or things like that as well too. Just looking for a good way of having a private public partnership there for the window.
Okay, appreciate it, Mel. Thanks for that presentation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So just a little formal, we'll just open this up to the public comment. Monique, is there anything from citizen comments on this that you're aware of?
No, we haven't received anything and there's no one on the line.
Okay, so we'll just open this up for discussion and just remember to announce yourself if you have anything to discuss. And if we need to make a motion on something, we can do that as well. But I'll open the floor up.
I do have a question.
Yes.
So how do you access the window?
If there's a door in the back in the parking garage that where it's locked all the time. You access it through the back that way.
Okay. Thanks.
There has been a bench placed. Unfortunately, it's right in front of the window now that wasn't there before the first part of the year. Ideally, it would be out at least a couple of feet because I don't know how you clean the window without getting dirt and debris on the bench itself. But that's another plus about having someone like myself in the window. It's to my it's in my best interest to keep the window looking ship shape, always keeping it look fresh and clean and presentable like that, and keep things interesting. The display for the backgrounds could also be a really neat. I have a graphic design background. I'm a painter and have worked for a contemporary art museum there in Minneapolis. So I know a lot about setting the stage for artworks and things like that. So the windows could be really beautiful and something that people would look forward to. And what I like about the window also is that after hours, people always talk, we get a lot of visitors and they say, well, what happens after 6 o'clock? You know, you guys roll up the sidewalks. And I think the nice thing about the window is the lights on timers could be left, burning till, the later hours of the morning where people could walk by and just enjoy it that are walking the street like that too.
Any other discussion?
This is Mary Cruz Fincher, counsel for the city of Franklin. I would, we would have to revisit the idea of any type of marketing, advertising, or monetary aspect with consideration to this application. I think that the way I understood the application was that it was a request to add art to the window. And I think that's within our authority to at least the FPAC to vote on. But if we're going to add some type of advertising or monetary component, I think that's something that we would have to look into. I'm not sure that the city is able to enter into that kind of partnership, or at least the commission is, the FPAC commission.
I appreciate that because I was having the same thought that I love the art aspect of it and how that promotes it and gets it out there, but I wasn't sure where these funds were going to. I saw somebody notes that you're selling some things and then they can go to a code or website to buy some things, and who's that going to? So I wasn't sure how that was working. But yeah, the idea of promoting work of artwork and all that is one thing, but if we're trying to advertise for sale for monetary, that's what I was questioning also. So thank you for that.
And even for our City Hall art policy, we can't have prices on those things either. So I would assume this will probably be the same way. It couldn't have prices at the least, but that's something that we can look into some more. And about leasing that space in a parking garage, I'm not sure we can do that either.
I don't see how you can't open this. It would have to be open up to all people. So it would almost be like a little miniature gallery that we already have in City Hall. It's a wonderful idea, but I feel like it has to be opened up to all artists that want to exhibit there for a period of time. Out of fairness.
Is
that right?
If this applicant applied to use the, it would be for a period of time. And so then another applicant could possibly use it for a different period of time. It wouldn't be.
Got it, I misunderstood. I thought it was like in a extended, okay. Like I understand.
It wouldn't be an indefinite permit. Is my understanding of it.
So what do you think the move is on this? Is this something we have a motion to discuss further, defer, or move on? I just want to ask that on the legal side until we try to figure out some of the details here.
Gary, if I could maybe offer a little bit, and maybe know a little bit about how to proceed. Asking the applicant, Mel, would you be interested in just placing artwork that you created in this display box?
I don't know. It that does require, I mean, the framing is expensive and things like that. So, I mean, I know where you're coming from, and it's that's always a tough, difficult balance there, you know.
Let me help with it. I just want to be respectful of everybody's time to get at Gary's point. If that's not a quick yes or no answer for you, then it's a different conversation outside of the purview of our Public Arts Commission. If you're willing to display a piece of art that you created, that's what this group does, and we could make that happen, whether it's in our Fire Hall Gallery in City Hall or it's in a display area like this, or else another public property. But if you're looking to use it more as you've described, which I appreciate your candidness here, then that's a different conversation that we will have to go down a different route to see if the Board of Mayor and Aldermen are inclined to allow this to be opened up for other merchants, artists to display their wares. So I think it's best that the commission defer it. And then Mel, if you change your mind again, displaying a piece of art that you want to bring to the commission and eventually to the board, we can always do that.
Can I suggest one other thing too? If this is a no-go, there is a, I can't remember the city, I don't know if it's Boston. They had a window that they would swap out, they'd have artwork in for a month or so, and they would rotate it out every so often, where there's applications and that type of thing. I know it's a lot more work for somebody to do, but it's also a nice use of the window, if not for me, you know. I hate to see it just sit there, and I don't think the Battle of Franklin Trust is really that interested in using it to its best advantage. And it's a shame, because it's just a really nice spot, and I think people could really learn from it and enjoy it. And there's already lighting outlets there. It's just all someone have to do is come in and really use the space. But if it's something you guys may want to kick around, if it's not for me, you know, I can understand, you know, I understand the issue of where I'm coming from, but you have to understand, if I'm buying these pieces and framing them up, it's a lot of investment, you know, that way. But I can send some examples from these other cities where I did some research at these little pocket galleries, they call them. But I'm sure it would take some board of you guys probably to review every submission and that type of thing of the artworks that would be featured in that window, if that's something you guys wanted to do. But I just mainly want to see the window used for something other than what it is now, because it looks really sad. And I think it's something that everyone could really benefit from in downtown.
Well, I think the other point to be made too, Mel, hi, I'm Brandy, nice to meet you, is that it would need to be the recognition to the artist, not the vendor. And I think that's what separates the opportunity for us as a Public Arts Commission, is that we would be showcasing the artist. And instead of, I mean, you have a very strategic and unique space in what you do, that you take art that is rare, that is not necessarily you as an artist. So we would be featuring your artist as opposed to, and I think for us, what we've done historically, which is a very small window, it's about local artists instead of things that you would see, and this is a stretch, but things that you would see displayed at like the Frist or other museum type pieces. I think our desire is to celebrate local artists and their work. But I could be wrong. I think that's kind of where our scope has been previously. So
I totally understand. I had always just saw the window sitting there, not really being used. It was like, it's felt kind of such an afterthought. There's like cobwebs in it now and the signs are all crooked. And that's the only reason I even, you know, proposed this is during this time last year, I saw the gallery going away and I thought there's some way we could continue that presence, because I know so many people like this type of historical artworks. But I know it was kind of a long shot for me. And I know it's a tricky thing when you're dealing with public and private as well too. I was just trying to figure out a way of getting the pieces out there and have people learn from these neat historical pieces like that. But I understand where you guys are coming from as well too. And it might be an opportunity for local artists like myself and Mr. Harwood and all these other artists to showcase their work there in the window and as well too. It's a great 5x7 window. I look at it all the time as I drive by, and it's all set up for lights and ready to go. And I think it'd be a nice addition to downtown Franklin, however you guys choose to use it.
Well, and I'm sorry it's dirty. We're going to get on that this week, right, Vernon?
I didn't mean to throw the Franklin under the bus.
We have the same problem with elevators. That's what public is for, to let us know in the dressing.
Okay. Well, in the meantime,
we'll get on that. And the idea is to open it up for local artists. We can do that, and potentially high school students too. So I will, Monique and I and our facilities manager will get it cleaned up.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
All right, guys, come see me at Rare Print sometime. I'll show you some really nifty things, okay?
Very good. Appreciate it, Mel. Thank you for it.
All right, you guys, be good.
Thank you. Have a good night. Okay. Item number five, right? Yeah, number five. Discussion of McEwen Northside mural. Looks like Vernon, you're going to lead this discussion, I take it?
Well, maybe
seven.
This is
I kind of know where you're coming from on this one. I've worked on the project and I asked you about this, so but
yeah, this is and I'm sorry, I can't pull up the illustration, but I can be brief. Yes. As part of the Northside or the McEwen Place project that Gary's working on, as a matter of fact, as part of that approval, the Board of Mayor and Aldermen, before the Public Arts Commission was established, approved the mural. And I'm going to let Gary explain it. What I didn't, or what we talked about, we didn't want this mural to be installed without the Public Arts Commission knowing that it's already been approved by the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. And after Gary explains it, should you have some concerns, we can have more discussion. Again, this is the McEwen Northside development across to the north of Brick Tops, where the new Perry's is, and several other businesses and hotels. But Gary, go ahead. And that was the purpose of placing it on the agenda. More of an FYI.
Yeah, I appreciate that, Bernie, because I was a little confused after I thought about it. But so McEwen Northside is a master plan mixed use project that was started by Southern Land probably in 2003 or five, sometime before that. Well, Southern Land backed out of the project, and Boyle and Northwood Raven purchased the project, about 45 acres. It's north of Whole Foods on McEwen, behind CarMax. There's an office tower there, apartments, the Jenny's Ice Cream, Perry Steakhouse Hotel. So we were instrumental in the master plan, working with both of those developers to take it back through the board again. And we did all the hardscape, landscape, streetscape. If you haven't been out to that park in front of Jenny's and the wine bar, you need to take a look at that. But as part of that approval, they had the right, they asked for modification standards at that time, that they could do art pieces, mural pieces, alternative signage that was approved by the Mayor and Board of Aldermen. So it was already kind of written into the master plan, so to speak, that they could do items like this, which is very unique, that we'd like to do all the time. So when we were working on this project, a wine bar jewel box, we call it, that would be opposite of Jenny's Ice Cream and the Central Plaza, with the fire water bowl in the middle and the synthetic turf in the plaza. There is a blank facade on this two-story wine bar that faces the what we call Festival Street. It's a very interactive street that has a blank facade, and they commissioned the artist who did the angel wings, I believe, down in Nashville. So she proposed this art piece of the kites that somebody can stand on there and take a photograph and post it on Instagram or other social medias as part of the project and promote the project itself, but also artwork in general, which is great for the city of Franklin. So that's kind of this came to be. And then when I saw it come, and we also, Ellie and myself met with Boyle also and said, hey, we know McEwen Northside is gonna be a very unique project. We'd love to see art in this project. And they said, yeah, we wanna do art. in different ways. And this is probably just one of many that will probably come through this project in general, because it's just starting in development. So that's kind of how this started. But like Vernon said, I wanted to get this, we wanted to get in front of the commission just to show that this is something that's going to be done as part of this project.
But, any reactions, Gary? I think I'd ask for, you know, just some reactions to it.
Yeah, if there's any discussion, and if you've had a chance to look at kind of that mural and also where it sits on the building, and how it creates a unique opportunity for people to interact with. But go ahead, any questions, comments, be happy to answer.
I think it's quite the coup, because I tried to get her to do something for us being High Hopes a few years back, and she was booked and popular and expensive. And yes. I think the following that she has with what she's done in Nashville is great. And I'm glad that we have this opportunity. So
I think it's beautiful. I think it's interactive. I'm all about it. It's great, great work there. Yeah.
Is the background going to be green? Is that the true color of this?
I'm not sure, Kelly. I would think so, but I'm not positive.
Okay. I like it. I think it's beautiful too.
I think it's lovely. I think it works.
Yeah, the scale of it is about, yeah, it's very, it'd be a massive piece on this blank facade if you saw that image that was a part of the packet. It'll be very
good. That on the side of a wine bar will get posted a whole bunch.
I think we're lucky to have this if it happens.
I think it's pretty much a go.
I love this. Does she have, and I can't remember, does she have a hashtag on those wings?
I don't know.
I think she does.
I wonder if she could add a hashtag to this one so it really gets a lot of eyes on it on social.
I think the hashtag is what lifts you.
It's a great idea.
Yeah, if there's any way we can tie both to the project and to the city of Franklin, that would be ideal.
Yeah.
We could get it on all aspects. I'm not sure how that works, but I guess something we could ask Boyle Development about how that be interacted with the city. I'm not sure.
Thank you, Gary, and thank you, commissioners. Just wanted to, again, get this in front of you so you weren't surprised, and if somebody asked you questions, you know how it came about. And it's another piece of art, and we're making progress, and that's all a good thing for our community.
Absolutely. Thanks for bringing this to us, Vernon. I appreciate it. Yeah. Were there any citizen comments on that, Monique? I doubt it, but just want to ask.
No.
Okay. Appreciate it, everybody. Item number 8, announcements and other business. I guess next meeting is May 19th. No proposals at this time. But we will need to vote for chair and vice chair. So is that time again already? Wow.
Once a year.
Anything else, Monique or Angela?
No.
Okay. Anything else from anybody else before we adjourn? So do I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
Megan, second. So we'll close out with the motion to adjourn. Brandy?
Yes.
Sherry?
Yes.
Julie's absent. Kelly?
Yes.
David?
Yes.
Ashley?
Yes.
Nan?
Yes.
And Gary Vogren, aye. So the ayes have it for motion to adjourn. Good to see everybody. Appreciate everybody's time.
Thank y'all.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Take care, everybody.
Bye.